asylum. Thanks to Swami for making this satsang possible. Thank you very much for being here this morning. Thank you for your time. All satsangs are meant for mutual growth and development. I consider that I am learning by trying to share my views with you. So we are learning. Each one teach one. It's not a question of anyone being extra in their knowledge or experience. I'm very clear. This session is intended for questions that I faced at the national retreat held in United Kingdom, the Great Britain. The questions are quite interesting, and they will also give us some insights. Therefore, with that view, I wanted to share with you those questions. Before I go into the questions and answers, I would like to just share with you little knowledge I have on questions and answers in general, not with particular reference to this. Questions continue. Questions after questions continue. Questioning is always a search. Questioning is always an inquiry. Questioning is inquisitive. Questioning is born out of curiosity, inquisitiveness, curiosity, of inquiry are all behind questions put forth. Further, question also comes out of a position when we have some earlier or previous knowledge or information about it. And questions are put with a deep feeling of eliciting information, of knowing more and more of the information that we want to learn and know. Some questions may be put only to get the answer in support of what I am already thinking. Meaning, I want yes from you, that's all. This is one sort of questions. The another sort of questions are those that they go on asking on the same thing only to let you know how much I know. I go on asking only to let you know how much I know. That's one thing. But final thing is this. In a spiritual journey, question and answer cannot be viewed in a materialistic way, in a worldly sense. In a materialistic way, question answers are based on logic and reasoning. Logic and reasoning. The logic and reasoning are applicable to the psychology or the frame of mind or intelligence. But the true spiritual knowledge is beyond the mind, where logic and reasoning utterly fail. So what shall we do now? It is a quest. It is not a question, but a quest. Quest is different from a question. Question may stop after getting a satisfactory answer. question may lead to another question to get some more detailed information. Question may be put to draw some explanation. Question may be put only to endorse, to acknowledge what I am feeling is correct. So these are all logic-oriented or reasoning-centered questions of the material world. But in spirituality, it is a quest. What is a quest? What is a question? Question needs an answer. Quest does not need an answer. Even if we give answer, the quest continues. Whereas question ends with an answer. The aim of question is an answer, but the quest has no answer. Because quest goes on and on. Therefore, my friends, in spiritual dimension, it is not a question, but it is a quest, an eternal quest in search of truth, where answer is not expected from outside. In question-answer, I question, you answer, you question, I answer. But in quest, nobody to answer anybody, because the answer is already there. So hum, I am that. That answer is already in me. What is the quest? Koham. Who are you? Who are you? Koham is a quest. The answer is Soham, I am you, which is within. Soham is not an answer given by others. Soham is answer within. I am that. I am that. Therefore, question answer is different from a quest and a question. In a quest, there is only an answer but no question. Whereas question has an answer. A question has an answer which gives a scope to doubt. Whether you give the answer, it may be correct or not, who knows? Because we are an elderly man, senior man, well, I may have to say yes, though I am not convinced. Though I don't say yes to you, because, yeah, well, I may say, I cannot say you are wrong, because I don't want to hurt your feelings. Courtesy, etiquette, or manners, decency, whatever you may call, will not help me to contradict you. Because the answer itself gives a scope to doubt. It needs to be confirmed, affirmed, and reconfirmed. But quest, for which there is an answer within, is beyond doubt. Koham, who are you? Quest. Answer, soham, I am that. Do you doubt it? No. When once that soham is realized or experienced, is there reasoning? No. Is there any other question? Question is out of question. Therefore, questions and answers from the material world gives a scope for doubt and also confusion. Why some people answer questions such a way that we forget the question. By the verbosity or gimmicks, whatever you may call it. Confusing. And then the answer sometimes, if you say, is it what you said? No, no, what I mean is. Why do you say that what you do not mean? Why do you say that what you do not mean? Say that what you mean or else keep quiet. So in the worldly sense, answers are ambiguous. Answers are ambiguous. Answers give a scope to doubt. Answers also need some proof or some standard approval. You may say, according to what scripture can you say that? What Upanishad says that? What scripture agrees with your statement? So scriptural sanction is necessary for answers. I enjoy God within myself. While singing bhajans, I am lost. While listening to Swami's discourse, I am in a state of bliss. Do you need scriptural support? No. Do you put to voting whether it is correct or not? Voting, dating won't help you. Because it is your own. Therefore, the quest does not need any support. Quest does not need any acknowledgement, any scriptural sanction, because you are the witness. But in the worldly question answers, they are full of doubts, full of ambiguity, full of confusion, that necessarily need scriptural sanction. So that's all about questions and answers, which I wanted to share with you as a prelude, as a soup for dishes to follow the question and answer session I had in UK at the National Retreat at a place close to Manchester, attended by about 800 people, mostly youth members. If pleasure and joy we get out of this world is a reflection of the bliss of yourself, then where does pain and sorrow reflected from? I read the question once again. If pleasure and joy we get out of this world is a reflection of the bliss of yourself, then where does pain and sorrow reflected from? Good question. Such questions are necessary, my friends. Not a question, what about your dream yesterday? What is your dream day before yesterday? When did you first come to Swami? When you come first or last, we remain only in the last. First to last to seniority would not last. These things should throw some light to awareness, should also keep us at higher levels of comprehension, understanding. So the question is this. Left to me the self, I am the bliss, Ananda. If that bliss is to be reflected outside, it should be Ananda only. If I am there in front of the mirror, only my reflection, not you. Am I right? If I look at the mirror and say, how are you, sir? Then I should go to the mental hospital. Similarly, if I am the true bliss, if that blissful experience is there within me, what I reflect, it also should be blissful. But here the question is, if you are bliss in spirit, how do you account for joy and pain in the outside world that you experience? I can only say, the joy and pain are the experience of the mind, the dual mind. Bliss is the experience of the heart. So this question of pleasure and pain, the dual mind, is not out of the bliss. It is only out of the extrovert, outer, physical, ephemeral, psychological, plane, the mind only. Because joy and pain are dual. Duality is the nature of the mind. Whereas bliss is non-dual. I can say happiness, unhappiness. Pain and pleasure. Joy and sorrow. Bliss, unbliss. Inbliss. Imbliss. Nothing nonsense. Bliss is bliss. So bliss is non-dual. So when this non-dual bliss is my true self, how do I experience joy and pain outside? Therefore, I know that I am the bliss at the level of the mind, which is at heart in its place, but the mind is questioning which is outward, which is dual, joy and pain. Therefore, what my answer is, experience that bliss within. Experience that bliss in its true form, in its true nature, non-dual nature. Then you don't find any pleasure or pain or joy, anything like that. So the joy and pain is only reflection of the mind, but not the reflection of the heart. Second question. Can there be anger without an underlying desire? So, if so, how can we avoid desire formation? Good question. See that. UK is always okay. Yes. Good. For brainy people, that too, most of them are youngsters. We cannot dupe our youngsters today. When we were tiny tots, what our grandfather said? Yes, yes. What our father said? Yes, yes. What our grandmother says? Yes, yes. Today you talk to your grandson, he will immediately tell grandpa, why don't you take rest? You are outdated. You are outdated. You have no computer knowledge. You don't have any awareness of the space sciences. You don't know what iPod, iPad. So, please, take rest, you are a retired man. You should not speak for long because breath problem will be there. All these things politely he will say, only to make us keep the lips tight. That's all. So we cannot convince our grandchildren. They're finished. So the youngsters, right from age of 4 to 5, full of reasoning, brainy people, all the people with children and grandchildren will certainly agree with me. If any parent says, my son is silent, he will never question me, please question his intelligence. Please be sure that he is a fool or a dunce. They question. Therefore, such questions come here. And what we elders to do is, to get ourselves updated. Updated. We have to get ourselves updated to continue to be young. If we are outdated, we are close to cemetery. That's all. Only date of expiry is awaited. Date of manufacture is known, the date of birth. Date of expiry is only any moment. Why? Why can't we update ourselves? Why not? Life is a process of continuous learning. Life is a process of continuous acquisition of knowledge. Life is a continuous process of experience, a new experience, vibrant, vital. Vital means living, dynamic. So you cannot say, I cannot learn at this stage, I cannot understand at this stage. In what stage you will know? You live in prestige, but not this stage, which is the so-called prestige, is false again. The so-called prestige you think is not prestigious. Therefore, my friends, we have to update ourselves. The question is, for anger, is the underlying desire responsible? Underlying desire, if it is fulfilled, There is no anger. Show me one fellow who got the gold medal, still angry? No. So anger, the desire fulfilled is not the source for anger. Desire unfulfilled is the source of anger. Then what should I do? I want to get a change from Swami at least. I could not get it. When he was giving change to some others, I used to doubt, why not me? Why not? Am I not eligible? So this desire crops up. What we should do is inquire the desire thoroughly. What is this desire? Investigate, inquire, observe that desire when it crops up. I want to be the president of India. Very good desire. Or you are not even municipal ward councillor. How can you be the president? Impossible. So whether the desire is genuine or not, whether the desire deserving or undeserving, we have to inquire the source of the desire, what desire it is. At home I simply started and reached Puttaparthi. And I sit there in darshan line. When Swami started giving vibhuti, I developed a desire, why not I get it? There was no desire at home. I was quite nice. During journey also I was a very good man. But in darshan line, when he gives you and avoids me, that is the trouble. I don't desire that I should also get it. And I have no intention to write a letter also. And I never wrote letters, that is pakka fact. All my friends know that. All right. By seeing others giving letters, Swami receiving letters, why not I also write a letter? Then what happens? He avoids you. Then anger. You received letter there, why not? So desire is born out of comparisons. First question ourselves, deserve? Do you deserve that fulfillment of the desire or not? And the second question is the desire born out of comparison or is it genuine or not? He may give some vibhuti to a person who is sick. You do not know. I do want a desire. You want to fall sick and again take the vibhuti? No, no. I think I told you sometime back, when Swami materialized vibhuti to a lady, all the fellows went on asking vibhuti. I know one fellow there. I called him. Aray, you, Swami gave vibhuti to that lady. Why do you want it? Sir, I want it. You know the reason? I just joked, that's all. You know why? That lady has no issues, no children. So he gave vibhuti now, and she is going to give birth to a child now. You want to be gynec? Let me know. Are you useless? Then, amma, I don't want, then go again. Therefore, my friends, by simply others having, why do you want to have? I also know some of the fellows come, sir, what a lovely car. He's simply going like that car, what a nice car. Nice car, correct. But the fellow inside is a heart patient. We'll give you that car. Are you ready to have heart complaint also? No, no, sir, I want the car, but not Adella Mudia. That's not possible. Accept it completely. Therefore, my friends, desire born out of comparison is meaningless, ridiculous. We become a laughing stock. We become a laughing stock. Somebody, Swami, talking to you. You are in charge of the stores here. I see you, Swami, talking to you every day. I feel, why not he talks to me? Why not? Then I become close friend to you in due course of time. and ask you, what is that Swami spoke to you? He scolded me for not doing my job properly. Do you want to be talked about like that? It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. We become a laughing stock in the process. So that is the source of desire. And third, if your desire is fulfilled, do you think it is for your own good? There is one demon by name Bhasmasura. He had a desire. Whomsoever I touch should die. Very good. Supposing if you want to scratch his head, finish. So he was touching everybody and everybody finished. They started dying one after one, like cricket score. Then Vishnu had to come in the form of a dancer, Mohini. And Vishnu, Mohini, the most beautiful lady on earth. And she started dancing. And this Bhasmasura also started dancing, because dancing together is celestial experience. So this fellow also started dancing. And that Mohini suddenly kept her hand on the head. This fellow doing that way, kept his hand also on his head. Hari Om Tat Sat, finished. So do you think that the fulfillment of your desire is for your own good? No. You are angry because your desire is not fulfilled. That only you know. But you do not know whether the fulfillment of your desire will give you ultimate good or not. Is going to be beneficial or not. So that also we should consider. That also we should consider. Sometimes Swami does not talk to you for 3 days or 4 days. Why? But he spoke to that man, immediately asked him to go. Why did he not talk to me for 3 days? Take it positively. He gave you the blessing to have darshan for 3 days. That man is simply Hari Om, you get up, that's all. When Pune comes there, I don't ask him to sit on the sofa and talk to him for hours. Do I do that? And what do you want? Yes, you may go. But when my relation comes, when my brother comes, I make him stay with me for 1 or 2 days and talk to him. When other fellow comes, hello, how do you do? Hi, how are you? Okay, see you later. See you later, not now. I don't want to see you now. So why don't we think that way? Swami did not talk to me for a couple of days because he wants me to have his darshan. The pleasure of seeing him for some more days, not being dispatched immediately after my arrival. Why can't we take that? Therefore, desire, we should take it, fulfillment or non-fulfillment, in a positive way. If we take in a positive way, the results of the desire, we'll never be angry. And how to remove desire? We cannot. If any fellow says, I have no desire, please take it from me. He has full of desires. Better he contests for the election. Only political people speak like that. I have no desire. Wrong. You have desire to have a hot cup of coffee in the morning. Right? You may not have desire to become President of India because you can never become. No, you have desires. You want to have that food and this kind of food, that kind of friend, this kind of a book. All our life is preferential. Life is based on choice. So long life is based on choice and preference, there are always desires. Our life is not a journey of choicelessness. No, our life is full of choice. I want to talk to him, I want to avoid him. I want to be here, I don't want to go there. I am peaceful here, I am not peaceful there. This is all choice. How do you say I have no desire? Nonsense. You do not know that you have no desire. I know that you are full of desires. Therefore, analysis of the desire, observation of the desire, the root cause of the desire, the motive behind the desire will help us to come out of that anger, born out of the desire. That is the answer. Then there's some questions, frequently asked questions it seems. The upper two are not frequently, maybe rare questions. The other questions are frequently asked. Let us see how frequent they are. When we are in Prashanta Nilayam or any other holy place, we feel very peaceful and happy. And that feeling lasts for some time, even after we return home. But it slowly dissipates once we start leading our daily lives. After more time, the feeling is more or lost. Now, question. How does one capture the peace that one experiences in Prashanta Nilayam and make it permanent in our life? Good question. Here people are very saintly. Sai Ram sir, Sai Ram sir. What do you want? Sai Ram sir. The very same fellow out of Prashanta Nilayam, what is the time? Oh, I have no time. Sir, when does the bus start? Oh, who knows? We look at the board. Are you telling Sai Ram, Sai Ram inside? What happened to that Sai Ram now? Meaning, the so-called peace that you experience here is only temporary. Something like the fellows who have drink is in a blissful state. Temporary. When the kick is gone, you will see him in his permanent state. So the so-called peace, the so-called love, the so-called affection, the so-called softness, gentleness, that is all artificial, IR-28 breed. Artificial. There are some plantains which are of this size. There are some capsicum, chilies of that size, but they have no taste at all. Yes. Then US, I saw some capsicum of that size, chilies. I thought it was very hot. I started eating. Even after eating 3 chilies, I couldn't get that kick of an original chili. Original cap, because only size. So this kind of softness, gentleness, it's all artificial, hybrid, vigor or heterosis. That is not spiritual. That is only lipstick. You have to put lipstick again in the evening. Morning you have put lipstick, again in the evening, again tomorrow morning. So this kind of peace that you experience in Prashanta Nilayam is only artistic lipstick. Because you don't have it outside. But that's not the purpose. The purpose of Swami is to bring transformation in you. Transformation is permanent. But this kind of behaving outside one way, within the campus in another way, is not transformation. It is only information. You see others very soft, so you don't shout. All are calm. How do you shout? If you shout, some other man is there to take charge of you. So, the so-called silence is not your nature. It is only the atmosphere that made you. And your habit is to talk loudly, to talk aloud. But you say, silence, because no one talks loud here. So, silence is influence of the place. Your soft talk is the influence of the place. But the moment you go out Prashanta Nilayam, you shout, you are loud, your true nature. That is not transformation. Because the transformation that you observed here is because of the ambience or the surroundings or the place. Then when Swami gives darshan, you feel very peaceful and blissful. Correct. But the moment you come out, you don't have that impression, the thought of Swami. The thought of Swami is not there. So what thought is there? The thought of your enemy, the thought of your boss, the thought of your neighbors with whom you share your daily tap water. Constant fighting and quarrels. How do you expect to be peaceful? You are peaceful here because the only thought is Sai. The only talk is on Sai. The only center is Sai. Sai is peace, peace is Sai, so you are peaceful. But outside what happens? Your thought is not Sai. Thought is the world. Thought your enemies, your friends, your loans, your pending bills. Then a peace is gone. Therefore, my friends, peace is in the thought. If the thought is peaceful, you are peaceful whether here or outside. How can the thought be full of peace? The thought can be full of peace because of Swami. This is what Swami says, constant integrated awareness. Constant integrated awareness, meaning the thought being full of Sai. Thought full Sai. Thought full of Sai. Then it is peace. Because Sai himself is peace. So if we have that outside inside, that peace remains. But if the so-called peace here being lost when once you are outside, it is not natural, it is not spiritual, it is not a proof of transformation which is expected. That's my answer. Third question. Families living in the West find it difficult to bring up their children in the ways that Swami would like us to do. Families in the West find it difficult to bring up the children in the Sai way. Who told you? Are you right? You are not completely right. Families in the East also find it difficult to bring children. Why do you speak of the West? East also equally difficult. East may be much worse also. Because Sai way is altogether new to the West. Even if few families are in the Western style, they are great. Sai style is quite ancient in this land. And if you cannot bring up, well, it's a matter of shame. Therefore, being not able to bring up children in the Sai way is not merely a problem of the West. It is equally a problem in the East also. Please be sure of that. Because I find many, many children, Western children, in Balavikas. I met many, many Western people who are more in a Sai way than most of the people in the East I met. So don't generalize East and West. That's individual matter. Whether individual is in Sai way or not, whether the individual is able to bring up his children in the Sai way or not, should be judged at the individual level. Not the East to West, it's not like that. They are the poles, but not the individuals. There are so many social pressures and there is no limit to attractions and distractions. He is speaking from the point of West. Are there not attractions in the East? Please tell me. And are there not distractions in the East? There are so many. If you go to Delhi, Bombay, Calcutta, Hyderabad, don't you have attractions, distractions? You just see the TV, Valentine's Day. You see the TV, New Year Day.
అయ్యయ్యో
హారిబుల్ హారిబుల్ ఈస్ట్ హైదరాబాద్ అండ్ ఢిల్లీ కల్కటా మద్రాస్ సో డూ యూ సే దెర్ ఆర్ నో అట్రాక్షన్స్ అండ్ డిస్ట్రాక్షన్ ద ఈస్ట్ దే ఆర్ ఎవ్రీవేర్ ఇట్ ఈస్ లెఫ్ట్ టు యూ టు అలౌ యువర్ సెల్ఫ్ టు దీస్ అట్రాక్షన్స్ ఆర్ డిస్ట్రాక్షన్స్ దెర్ సో మెనీ వైన్ షాప్స్ ఇన్ ది ఈస్ట్ ఎస్ వై నాట్ గవర్నమెంట్ ఈస్ గెటింగ్ లాట్ ఆఫ్ రెవెన్యూ అవుట్ ఆఫ్ ఇట్ దే ఎంకరేజ్ యూ టు డ్రింక్ సో దట్ దే కెన్ గెట్ రెవెన్యూ ఆల్సో So you cannot say drinking is an attraction, the best. No. You go to that crossroad. There are so many. There are some shops also, Sai Wines. Sai Wines. Oh, he is a devotee, why not? Sai Wines. There is some shop also at my native, Sai Timber Depot. How can you say no? Therefore, we cannot say distractions, attractions are limited to this. No, even here. It is left to you whether you allow yourself, whether you fall a prey to this or not. It is not limited to any other globe. What advice can you give based on what you might have heard Swami advise people in such situations? What are such situations? Attractions, distractions. Bringing up children, finding it difficult. That is the situation. Swami gives a beautiful example. Whatever I give only from Swami's examples, from Swami's discourses. That's why I'm little successful. Little bit. But if I start imagining using some words, hypothetical, theoretical, you may feel anyway, but I feel utter flop. Anything what I speak, if supported by Swami's message, whatever you may feel, I feel it successful. If it is not supported by His message, left to my imagination, you may be happy, but I am empty within. Therefore, I am giving answers from Swami's message. Swami gives an example of Bangalore, quite close. In summer, the whole land is dry. Akka. When rains start towards the end of May, lawns, grass starts growing. You have not sown seeds of grass, did you? No. But grass started germinating, sprouting up. Who have sown the seeds of grass there? I have not sown. Meaning, there are seeds already there. Rain helped them to germinate. Rain helped them to germinate. Similarly, there are seeds of all bad qualities within me. There are seeds of all that is cruel, wicked, dirty, ugly, seeds are within me. But in Puttaparthi, dry land. They are not allowed to sprout. Outside, aha, wonderful rain. The rain of horrible, terrible company. The rain of attractions, distractions. The reign of selfishness, domination, ego will help all my ego seeds to come out. The seeds of selfishness to come out. The seeds of prejudices come out. They are only my seeds. And outer rain helped me to come out in true colors. Therefore, let me see that there be no seeds within. To remove all those seeds which are evil, cruel, wicked, wild, horrible, terrible, is what is called Vasana Kshaya. This is how Bhagavad Gita puts it. Vasana Kshaya. Vasana Kshaya meaning to remove all these seeds from within. What is it that is called sadhana? Removing all the seeds within is sadhana and the spiritual practice. How do you do that? First by service, not by reading books, not by quoting, not being called a scholar. No, no, no. Service, bend the body first.